Hi folks, I'm Dr. Chapman. Today we'll take a look at the geology of Yellowstone National Park, mantle plumes, and heat flow within the Earth. Yellowstone in northwest Wyoming is an enormous volcanic caldera and sits above a huge shallow magma chamber or reservoir. The last major eruption occurred 640,000 years ago and was one of the largest volcanic eruptions on Earth. The eruption was more than 1,000 times larger than the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens. And it spread ash from Sonora to Saskatchewan and from LA to Louisiana.
We'd like it Cajun style.
The Yellowstone caldera is so large that geologists didn't even realize it was a caldera until aerial and satellite photography became readily available.
Where is it? I don't see it.
The caldera is about 65 kilometers in diameter. For comparison, Crater Lake in Oregon, which is no slouch in terms of calderas, has a diameter of 8 kilometers. Yellowstone National Park sits above a hotspot like the Hawaiian Islands. Most geologists think that Yellowstone hotspot is a result of a mantle plume. Mantle plumes are thought to originate at the core mantle boundary. Seismologists call this boundary the D double prime layer.
Hey, big D.
There's an enormous temperature gradient across the D double prime layer. The core is about 1,000 degrees Celsius hotter than the overlying mantle. Geophysicists have imaged two very large regions in the lowermost mantle with slow seismic velocities beneath Africa and the Pacific Ocean. The leading hypothesis is that these low velocity regions are places where subducted oceanic lithosphere has accumulated, sometimes called slab graveyards. The accumulated oceanic slabs may partially melt or just slowly heat up and become more buoyant than the surrounding mantle to generate mantle plumes. Based on the rate of plate subduction and slab sinking, geoscientists estimate that modern mantle plumes may have formed from oceanic slabs subducted around a billion years ago. We can't directly observe mantle plumes, but geophysicists have imaged them using seismic waves, and recent studies suggest that the Yellowstone plume originates at the core mantle boundary about 3,000 kilometers beneath San Diego. Geoscientists also construct numerical and analog models to understand plume dynamics, which show that as plumes rise to the mantle, the resistance of the overlying rock creates a bulbous or mushroom-shaped head with a thin tail attached to it. As the plume head rises into the upper mantle, it is thought to flatten out against the base of the lithosphere and undergo decompression melting. If you've watched the video on Crater Lake National Park, you'll know that deeper into the earth, as the pressure increases, higher temperatures are required to melt the mantle. This melting point or melting curve is called the solidus. If mantle rocks are rapidly brought up through the mantle, like in a plume, they experience a reduction in pressure and can start to melt, even without any change in temperature. This is called decompression melting. Decompression melting occurs in mantle plumes as well as in places like mid-ocean ridges and spreading centers. As oceanic plates are pulled apart, it allows mantle rocks to rise up and fill the space, and they can partially melt to form basaltic oceanic crust. Decompression melting in a rising plume head can produce extreme volumes of basaltic igneous rocks, called large igneous provinces, or LIPs,
or lips.
Your lips, my lips, apocalypse.
Where these magmas erupt onto oceanic crust, they form oceanic plateaus. And where they erupt onto continental crust, they form continental flood basalts. They flood out over the landscape in numerous lava flows because the basaltic magmas have a low viscosity. The Columbia River basalt in Oregon and Washington State are continental flood basalts linked to the arrival of the Yellowstone mantle plume head about 17 million years ago. The enormous volume of basalt was erupted in less than 2 million years, which is a really short time to produce that much volcanic rock. After a plume head dissipates, the long plume tail continues to heat up the base of the lithosphere and forms a hotspot. There is a change of volcanic deposits in old calderas that lead from the Columbia River basalts to Yellowstone, passing through the Eastern Snake River Plain. That records the movement of the North American plate over the hotspot. Much of this volcanism, including the large eruptions in Yellowstone National Park, is rhyolitic and forms from the accumulation and differentiation of magmas in the middle to upper crust.
Cake! I love cake so much!
The magma reservoir beneath Yellowstone is only 5 kilometers beneath the surface. And it's the reason why there's so many geothermal features within the park. Thermal features include hot springs, mud pots, fumaroles, and geysers. The park contains around 500 geysers, more than half of the total number of active geysers left in the world. Most of these features form as groundwater percolates into the earth and is heated by hot rocks and hot fluids exhaled from the magma, chiefly salty brines.
Aye, 'tis a sugary brine.
The shallow magma chamber and vigorous convection of fluids in Yellowstone means there's a lot of heat transfer to the surface of the Earth. Geologists usually measure heat transfer, heat flow, in the units milliwatts per square meter. The average heat flow for the continents is around 65 milliwatts per square meter, and the outer edge of Yellowstone National Park, away from the caldera, has similar heat flow values. Above the caldera, average heat flow is around 2,000 milliwatts per square meter. And around geothermal features, heat flow can be as high as 100,000. For comparison, the heat flow coming out of your body that you feel when you touch your skin is around 50,000 milliwatts per square meter.
I got a fever, and the only prescription is more cowbell.
Another way to think about heat flow is how fast it heats up as you go down deeper into the Earth, called geothermal gradient. Away from tectonic plate boundaries, in most places in the world, the geothermal gradient is about 20 to 30 degrees Celsius per kilometer. The average geothermal gradient in Yellowstone is around 100 degrees Celsius per kilometer. So where does all this heat come from?
It comes from cranberries.
In Yellowstone, it comes from a magma source. But what heated up that magma? More generally, why does it get hotter as you go down into the Earth? There's two main sources of heat in the Earth. Primordial heat, related to the formation and accretion of the planet, and radiogenic heat, produced by the radioactive decay of elements. In the mid-1800s, before the discovery of radioactivity, a physicist named William Thomson, later to be ennobled and elevated to Lord Kelvin, calculated the age of the Earth to be about 100 million years old. He made his estimate by measuring the current heat flow leaving the Earth and back calculated how long it would have been when the Earth was a giant bowl of molten rock. Based on his measurements, if the Earth was billions of years old, it shouldn't have volcanoes or magma. It should be a cold, dead planet.
Hey! I'm not dead!
What Lord Kelvin didn't know was that radioactive decay of elements in the mantle and crust provides a continuous source of heat. The main sources of radiogenic heat in the Earth are the radioactive isotopes of uranium, thorium, and potassium. You get dosed with around 0.1 microsieverts of radiation from eating a banana because of its high potassium content. For comparison, a chest x-ray is about 20 microsieverts, and a fatal dose of radiation is around 8 million microsieverts. So bananas are pretty safe. And besides, your body excretes the radioactive potassium before it can do any damage. The half-life of potassium-40 isotopes is 1.24 billion years. Half-life is the time it takes to reduce something by half. This means that the decay of radiogenic isotopes is exponential, and much more radioactive decay and heat was being produced in the early history of the Earth than is being produced today. It's for this reason that geoscientists think that processes like mantle convection were much more vigorous during the Earth's formative years, and features like mantle plumes may have been widespread. Imagine it, a world full of Yellowstones.
Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.